This is not normal. That is according to our first chart here, and it's from Konstantin Gurdjieff, who's an economist and an academic, a professor. And he is looking at a chart of the employment participation rate in the United States. This isn't normal, he says. This is a secular disaster. I'll just show you the participation rate going back to 1948, post-World War II, stayed flat at around, 60% of the US economy, adults, anybody between say 16 and 65. That included women who were stay at home at that time. This is the surge that we saw with all the women coming into the workforce from the late 60s. And now since 1999, 2000, we've had a plunging back to where we began. And we're about at 65%, I think there. Yes, 63% that was averaging right before this economic COVID lockdown, and now it's closer to 60%.
So this isn't the unemployment number. That's a different number. This is a kind of a broader view of the workforce in America, and it shows that the participation rate, that is the people who are working, participating in the economy, is heading down, and heading down in a shocking way.
These are the unnecessary expendable sort of population of the economy. And I think that's why you see all the opioid overdoses, this long-term like absence of any hope. There's no hope for many people in the economy, working age, adult population, and able-bodied. And we're gonna look at the male participation rate in particular soon, but first, if he says, Konstantin says that if you think we're getting back to normal, you need to check what normal you have in mind. Here is the unemployment rate going back to the 1948. And you know, unemployment is obviously cyclical, especially when we used to have business cycles. So when the business cycle was down, unemployment would go up, and then the business cycle would pick back up and people would be employed again. So this covers the long-term unemployed, those who are unemployed for a longer period of time, i.e. the business cycle is not short, business doesn't pick up, economic activity does not pick up. So this is for counting those who are unemployed for 27 weeks or longer. So, you know, these are all the recessions going back to the 1948. And from the last global financial crisis of 2008, we've seen a huge spike, a doubling of the normal. It used to be normal to the business cycle to complete. And now we have extreme long-term unemployment that sets in with each financial crisis. And remember, this is the period pre-central bank intervention in the business cycle here. This is post quantitative easing and intervention in the business cycle.
Right, so you're developing in the United States a permanent underclass. So these are people that will, for generations, remain poverty-stricken and no way to escape poverty now, and it's affecting 100 million people or more. And the second thing is that, as you point out, it has to do with the money printing. And speaking as a man, there is a couple of things that need to be satisfied. One, I need to have some kind of meaningful work. Or two, I need to be involved in some kind of existential conflict for the survival of my clan or my country. Mm-hmm. Now, money printing does neither. It simply placates. And so for the average man, this is an incredibly insulting, and it stirs up a lot of anger and resentment. And when men begin to realize this is done out of incompetence, and it's done from a place of moral ambiguity by the central planners, it becomes a bigger problem.
You see in the media that the elite and the knowledge economy members of the knowledge economy, those who, the winners, as Hillary Clinton called them, versus the losers. I think these are the costs, the cost of money printing, the cost of free money, the cost of preventing a business cycle, the cost of you know, a lot of this started post 1999-2000. So that is also when we got rid of the Commodities Futures Modernization Act, got rid of Glass-Steagall, and introduced China to the World Trade Organization on favored nation status, and they got to impose tariffs and stuff. So these are the costs. There are costs, and our media, of course, doesn't cover the costs. They don't debate issues. They declare how it is. And so we have to be honest and have this debate. It's like, these are the costs. You're going to have mass unemployment, partly because, you know, since 1971, we have the reserve currency, and you need a huge deficit in order to finance that, to enable that, because you have to send dollars overseas. We've covered that. You also have China, obviously, we can't compete with China when they could put huge tariffs on our goods, but we can't do the same according to WTO rules. And the Cantillon effect is like a reserve, the resource curse. So you don't need, like, why go through the cost and effort of manufacturing when you could just print money and give it to the elite first, and then it might trickle down to the people in the middle of the country. And, you know, so right. It's multi-leveled.
To focus on that moral ambiguity of the central planners and the money printers, and so to keep somebody who's the CEO of a Wall Street bank employed during a downturn in the economy, where they would have been fired or their bank would have gone out of business, that would be a normal business cycle. But the money printing has kept these insolvent institutions going and kept their CEOs being paid tens of millions or $100 million or more. So for every CEO of a Wall Street bank, that because of the moral ambivalence of the central planners, the central bank, the Jerome Powell, that means a million unemployed men. And so that is a cauldron of angst that is now showing its hand.
Right, and that financialization of the economy that has been enabled partly as well through this nonstop Fed intervention, when you had the Greenspan put introduced in the late 80s through the 90s, and then that's continued with all the central bank put and the rescuing of the financial sector and any, you know, listed stock company, essentially. So what that has enabled is the utter financialization of the economy. So you can't really invest in R&D, you can't invest in CapEx, like real, you can't build factories here because shareholders will penalize you, and it doesn't, there's no personal financial incentive for any of the executives to do that when they are more richly rewarded through stock options and things like that, of gaming the system and stock buybacks. So, you know, there's a huge myriad of things that are causing it. There's no one issue that's causing it, but in terms of the male participation in the economy, you see what Konstantin Gurdjieff calls no hope economics. And that is quite remarkable, going back to 1948, when we had over 85% of adult able-bodied men working, versus now we're down to about just over 65%.